Dog is Family on BCTV is supported by From Family Pet Foods.
Dog is Family, where we celebrate the bond between people and their dogs, where we explore all avenues of their mind, body, and spirit. And we bring you the latest and greatest information on caring for them, these beloved members of our families. My name is Barb Emmett, and I am the host for the next half hour, or probably an hour today. We have a lot that we're going to cover. And stay with us. Please get a pencil and paper out. We have so much information to share with you. And today's story is focused on canine cancer. I have two guests here. To my left is Dr. Jennifer Burroughs. Hi, Dr. Jennifer Burroughs. She is a doctor of veterinary medicine, and she's an integrative veterinarian who's going to share some very exciting and hopeful news and ways to live with and help your dog who may have canine cancer. And right at the floor, we also have my golden retriever, Charlie, and he is a 9-year-old golden retriever who really likes to come out and greet and meet people at the store, which is Godfrey's Welcome to Dogdom, and he loves to work there. And I thought I would bring him along today. He's very chilled and he likes to be part of the show. So thanks for having us in your home. We have a lot to cover. And this is very unusual for me because I have decided with the topic of canine cancer, hope, healing, and more for the future, that you can know there's changes coming and what you can do to be a proactive pet parent. I have lived through this, and unfortunately, and sad to say, the story that I thought I would tell is my journey in the beginning and what I did and found out about canine cancer and how I could help my golden retrievers. If we could show the first picture, I can show you three goldens of my husband's and mine. And I'll just tell you a brief story of them. To the left is my girl Emma. And in the center was Jackson, who was a greeter at my business and was beloved by many customers who come in and just want to be with him. He was an excellent shop boy, and he loved to work there. And to the right is Tucker, another golden retriever. And that was our family for many years as it changes. And of course, their lives are much too short. With Emma's situation, Emma had hemangiosarcoma. And that is one that golden retrievers tend to get as one of the top cancers. And it comes on very, very quickly. And when we had a diagnosis for her, the veterinarian at the specialty hospital said to me, you do know what you're in for, and you have 2 weeks probably with her. And we said, we know. We unfortunately lost a dog to hemangiosarcoma before. We're taking her home, and she's going to live our life with us, and we will do what we can with her. And it was another month with Emma, but it hit very fast, hemangiosarcoma. We'll talk more about that. And to the center is Jackson again, who worked there. And this interesting story of Jackson was that he also then worked there at the store. And one evening, it was a Friday, I'll never forget it, it was in the summer. And I looked down at his face and I thought his one jaw, his cheekbone didn't align to the other. And just like a very small little bump, and I felt it and I thought, that's bone. What could that possibly be? But we were supposed to go to an Animal Rescue League fundraiser that evening. We had tickets, we had plans. It was 5 o'clock in the afternoon and I said to myself, I want to take him. I want my vet to see him. Something's off. And one of the people in my store said to me, I don't see it. I don't know what you even see outside of his cheeks. I don't even understand what you're seeing. And she was very symmetrical at the time and very much in alignment. And I said, they're just not quite aligned. I can't explain it. So I got an appointment, thankfully, that day. Canceled our plans for the evening. And our veterinarian looked inside hoping for an abscess, which would be a lot simpler. And unfortunately, it wasn't. It was a growth. It was an oral tumor growth that had grown way back behind his mouth that had already done damage. Now, there was no obvious evidence of him having a problem before. He was chewing. He was doing everything he normally did. And at that point, we were on the journey. And we were way on the journey with running to a veterinary oncologist in Langhorne, thankfully. And this is your journey when you find something that just rocks your world. And you think, my goodness, we were fine yesterday. We're not fine today. What do we do? Who do we turn to? And of course, your veterinarian is your first point of contact. And our veterinarian had given us some diagnostics with what he could do in his office. And he said something very interesting to me. And there's been so many lessons on the way. He said, I just came from a conference out west, and this could be taken care of. I've seen this amazing surgeon who can be able to take the half of your dog's face, lift it up, replace the jawline. He may go blind, and they would reconstruct the jawbone. He said, it's very exciting, and it can be done. And I said, but doctor, I need to know more. I don't have enough information about how big this is and what we're really dealing with before I can make any decisions about his care or his surgery. What else can we do? How can we learn more about exactly what this is? Because he still didn't have enough either. So he had suggested a CAT scan. So we were at the veterinary oncologist. Blessedly, this is very interesting. She knows the cancer rates for golden retrievers are very, very high, over 60% in the US. And she had a 5-month-old golden. She took our golden back and she did the CAT scan of him, and she came in the room. And when she came in the room, I was reading this book at the time. She had it in her office, and it's Help Your Dog Fight Cancer. And it is by Lori Kaplan. And I was looking through it and panicking, thinking, what are we going to learn? She came back in the room, and she was so kind. She was excellent. And she said, I would never do surgery on this dog. She said, I want to show you how expansive it is. So we went. She showed us the whole CAT scan, and she said, it's huge. She said, take him home and love him. So that's what we did. So these are stories to tell you that while you're on your journey, there may be things surgically that can be done, but do we want to have them done? Are there other ways? Palliative care, what does that mean? Is integrative medicine the right approach? Is there something else we can pick up from natural care? That was Spencer's journey. That was a tough one because he worked in the store. And people would come in and greet him and want to know his story. At that point, I was lost. I had nowhere else to go. My veterinarian was not going to do chemo or radiation. The oncologist was not suggested at all. There was no surgery to do. And I said, I'm lost. I want to help his last days here together. Where do I turn? What do I do? At the time, 10 years ago, there wasn't much out there. I knew there were integrative veterinarians. Dr. Diva Khalsa was one from Philadelphia who moved from the area and went to New Zealand. Dr. Karen Fox had moved. She was integrative. I was lost. So I want to share with you this specialist that I had found. And, you know, we don't blink our eyes at this. This was an online help for me, Dr. Demian Dressler from Hawaii, who had been on his own journey of his dog with cancer. He addresses not only the body and trying to heal, he addresses your emotional health, your budget, what you're willing to do, and how you can work through this after you get that diagnosis. It rocks your world. One day they're fine and one day they're not. This book was a lifesaver for me 10 years ago. And Dr. Jen, I believe you had heard of Dr. Demian Dressler.
Correct.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Dr. Jennifer Burroughs. you had heard of him. And so there was tons of information. So then I didn't know where I took that information, though. And I thought, I can change things. And I did start making phone calls to different veterinarians. And some folks were helping. But I got a lot from this book. And at the time then, what also rocked my world was Dr. Demian Dressler had created a book called The Dog Cancer Diet Guide. I've always believed that food is medicine. When I got a hold of this guide, he definitely had specifics that you could use to help your dog with diet changes. And I know Dr. Burroughs is going to really help us with this today. I didn't have that help then. And I also, at the time, was for my business at a trade show. And there was another veterinarian that was integrative, and she had created, it introduced me to seminars. She did many seminars on Chinese herbal medicine. Well, that opened my eyes. And I said, a lot of this makes sense. Where do I go at home with help? I don't know where to go. But I gleaned enough information to help me on the path that let me say to myself, I can help my dog. And that's what we're here for. So these two were incredible guides. Take the information out. He's got it out there. So between these three, it really helped me on my path. So whether you want to or not, you are your dog's best advocate for health care. You are the one who decides, do I take a passive role or do I take an active role? Can I do more? And oh my goodness, yes you can. In today's world, from 10 years ago, it's terrific. I want to, what I want to show you is a little bit of hope, and it jumps kind of right into feeding and what we're feeding, but it does talk about the epidemic of cancer in canines, which is out there. What is it, Dr. Burroughs? About one in four of our dogs that we love is going to experience some kind. My last dog that was shown on that picture was Tucker, and he, within 3 days, we had figured out he had had a rectal tumor. Now, it was very quickly. It came about very quickly. We lost him. There was nothing again at that point. I mean, he had been going normally to the bathroom until one day. And suddenly he had a neurologic change in his back foot, and suddenly he was not going to the bathroom. He had been going to the bathroom fine. So at that point, the only hope there was surgery to crack the back hip bones, try to remove that. His spine, he had already lost some neurologic issues. Just to know that things can really, really, really creep up, and we loved our, I mean, we did everything we could for them. So cancer's a biggie. There's so many kinds. We want to get at this and figure out, there are many people out there that are doing such a good job on the front lines, bringing this to the forefront. There's science, and there's integration of procedures, and there's new ways of looking at things every day, I believe, don't you? I mean, there's just so much research and information. I want to show this video, and then we'll move forward with more for you. This is a dog cancer series. And I'm thinking our connection may not be going. Is it going? Okay, maybe it's not. Okay, it's not going to show us, so we might have to move on. I'll try this one more time if you bear with us, and maybe Dr. Jennifer Burroughs has a few comments while we get this going again. It's not going to let me play it. Let's show the, and we maybe get back to that. Let's show the list of resources that I brought in, if we can do that. What I want you to have information at your fingertips is this dog cancer series coming in March, which I would show you a trailer, and hopefully I'll be able to do that. It's groundbreaking research, and it's at the top. It's groundbreaking research in a six-hour documentary with information from 50 oncologists, cancer researchers, and veterinarians. And it's going to be available March 8, 2018, so please check that on your internet site. Amazing amount of information. Two people that went across the world and have been advocates for all of this. The next one I'd like to call attention to is the dogcancerblog.com. And that is Dr. Demian Dresser's blog. You can find tons of information. You can pick up this book, The Dog Cancer Diet, The Dog Cancer Survival Series, because he acknowledges your emotional component to stay positive and know that you can do more for your dogs. Another one on that is Help Your Dog Fight Cancer, The Cancer Land of Pure Gold, which is incredible, has so many resources, and I think you'll be very happy with that. And what else? Let's see if we can show a few more. Oh dear. The caninecancer.com. We'll go down to the American College of Veterinary Internal Medicine, where you can find a board-certified veterinary oncologist in your area, and you would use searching for dog owners. And what else? The acfoundation.org, which is the Animal Cancer Foundation, We Are the Cure, Puppy Up, the MorrisAnimalFoundation.org, which is doing an incredible amount of help with getting people out there knowing what is going on in the world of cancer research and working with golden retrievers and blood work. And we're going to have someone on to talk about that. If you could scroll down that list a little bit. We should get this going. We'll show a little bit more on that list. This was working. And I believe the video may be coming up to help you understand what the series might be presenting to you when it comes out in March. Well, we are having some technical difficulty there, I guess, so we'll have to move on that one. I don't know. Maybe we can go back to that. Okay. Next, then, that's my story. There's much more to come. You see our Charlie here, 9 years old. We're praying that health is good, that we're not dealing with any cancers. He's very relaxed. And our other golden retriever that you saw in the beginning, personally, Lake as well. So the journey's a real one. Stay with us. We're going to now move to Dr. Jennifer Burroughs.
Hi.
Hi. How was that story? I held it together pretty well.
That was wonderful.
I know
you
have your own.
Thank you for sharing it.
You're welcome. And I know you have your own. I'd like to read a little biography about Dr. Jennifer Burroughs. She obtained her doctorate of veterinary medicine degree from the University of Florida and her certification in veterinary acupuncture from the Qi Institute of Traditional Chinese Veterinary Medicine. She has completed advanced training courses in veterinary acupuncture and is currently pursuing certification in canine rehabilitation therapy. She believes the strengths of conventional and traditional veterinary medicine should be utilized to provide the best medical care. And she's the owner of Sundance Veterinary Wellness in Lititz.
That's me.
That's you. All righty. Take us through, give us a little summary of you, and then we'll move to some information you want to do. You tell us when you're ready.
Sure. That was a wonderful introduction. Thank you for,
you're welcome.
For having me today. It's a pleasure to be here.
I'm very excited to have met you, to know that your services are available for me and for all of the customers I know that need you.
It's wonderful.
So take it away.
Speak along your lines of your story is I had a similar story, and I remember that feeling of being blindsided, kind of hopeless when you hear those words that your dog has cancer, and you don't know what to do, and you don't know where to turn and where to go, and you just want to help.
Yeah.
And so I'm thankful that there are treatment options available from a conventional standpoint, from a non-traditional standpoint, that we can integrate and use both. I think that's a wonderful time that we're in now, and we have a lot of research. I mean, look at all the research that's ongoing into why cancer rates are rising and what treatment options are available. So I'm thankful for that. And my plan today is to share some integrative treatment options for cancer, and it's going to be from a traditional Chinese veterinary medical perspective.
So, may I ask you a question before you jump in? Like, how... You're in conventional medicine, you had your doctorate in veterinary medicine, and what propelled you to move forward into integrative care personally?
Personally, I felt like I wanted more. I wanted more for my patients. I wanted more for myself and for my pets.
Okay.
And so I started just researching and learning more about what else is out there.
Yeah. Oh, that's
and
excellent.
And found this path, and I just knew that this was what I was supposed to do. This was how I could help.
Excellent. Oh, that's wonderful.
From there. So I'm very thankful for that.
I'm very thankful for you. Because as I said, there wasn't really good places to go.
Right?
Next is, where's our next? PF5. Are we advancing?
Where
are we advancing? There we are. I got it. Should have it. There we go.
Isn't technology grand?
When it works, it's great. And some days it goes so fast, I don't even know what's going on. And it's perfect. And then other days, I don't know what happens. And I have
that's just how it
Apple,
is.
Apple, and it's different.
No worries at all.
Here we go.
So I
take
thought
us through.
I will start. I thought I would talk some about traditional Chinese veterinary medicine, or TCVM, because that's just easier to say. But it is a holistic practice that is based on the Taoist worldview that the body is essentially a microcosm of the greater universe. And so the laws and forces that govern the external world, like Mother Nature, also govern our internal body's environment. TCVM views the body as a whole entity, and so it really identifies an underlying pattern to treat disease. And when we view the body as an entire entity, we take into account not only the physical health, but also the emotional well-being, their mental well-being, and that involves things like their personality, their constitution, what's their diet like, their relationships at home, their environment. All of that plays a role in the pet's well-being, and then subsequently in the treatment and ideally prevention of disease.
It's perfect.
Yeah. It's wonderful, and there are two main theories for TCVM. The first is five-element theory, and that is that as the body passes through a season, it's the same similar seasons that the earth cycles through in its life cycle, and that each organ system correlates to an element in that seasonal cycle, and so they not only nurture one another, but they also control or keep each other in balance. And so if we have a deficiency or a weakness in one of those elements or organ systems, then we can't nourish the next element or organ system, and we can't help keep the others in balance. And so that's how five-element theory explains how the organ systems are related to one another. And then in yin-yang theory, that is that there are opposites in the universe that both mutually create and transform one another. So we can't experience light unless we've also experienced dark. And we don't know joy unless we've also experienced sadness. And so those are the balancing points in the universe and as well as in our bodies.
So those very interesting.
It can get very, very involved, but that's just kind of a very brief picture on what some of the theories are behind TCVM. So I'll have you click the next slide.
Okay.
Thanks. So based on that, when we talk about TCVM, when we define disease, we define disease as a pattern of disharmony or this imbalance in the body. And so our treatment goals are then to bring the body back into balance, back into harmony. And that's when all of our organ systems are working correctly and functioning properly. I'll have you hit the next one too.
Let's
go ahead and hit the next
slide. You ready for the next?
Sure.
So we're seeing fire, wood, water, yep. Metal, and
earth.
Okay.
Yeah. Wonderful. So for TCVM principles, and this really relates, I was trying to move down into what is cancer. So qi is considered our vital life force, our energy, and that's what circulates through our bodies. It nourishes and protects our organs. And a deficiency in qi is considered the root of all cancer development. And so when we have this weakness of qi, it can then lead to what we call stagnation or stasis. And that's where we'll have these nodules or masses or tumors form, when we have this blockage or the stasis of qi. And so our treatment principles for cancer involve strengthening the qi, tonifying it. We want to break down or resolve that stagnation, remove those pathogenic factors from the body, and then essentially detoxify the body. Those are our kind of four main goals for treatment principles for cancer. Based on that, we have four branches of TCVM. We have acupuncture, we have herbal medicine, food therapy, and shui na, which is Chinese medical massage. These form the basis of our treatment modalities that we'll use for pets. So I thought we would talk a little bit about each of them and how they relate.
That's super. Is that your puppy? No, that's not your puppy. Oh, no. Oh, that's, we go to the next one. Okay. We'll close that guy. We had to break you down. We had to break them down.
I got a little too wordy. What can I say?
No, no. Is it coming? There we go. All right, we're up again. Slide.
That's great.
Slideshow. Where are you? We are having trouble with our slides.
F5.
I didn't see the. It usually has the.
Oh, technology. I wanted it in one file. It was too big.
Sorry.
That's no problem. No problem at all. Charlie's still napping.
So Charlie's always happy.
Yeah. He's
Charlie
happy.
Charlie and the rest of you, we know you're with us.
Acupuncture is one of our main treatment modalities for cancer with TCVM. And I know it's been covered extensively on, you know, on the show before.
We have.
Just as an overview.
Please do.
It's really using small needles to stimulate very specific points on the body that we want to induce a physiologic and a therapeutic response. So we know that when we stimulate those points, we can release chemicals and hormones in the body that will help it heal. We can provide pain relief, and then we can have some local effects where we improve blood flow, we stimulate nerve conduction and function, and we relieve muscle spasms. Those acupuncture points are located on what we call meridians, which it's easy to think of pathways or highways in the body. And so if we promote the smooth flow of qi through all those meridians, we have normal function. So we use our acupuncture needles to treat cancer by starting to resolve that stagnation.
Do you have any client stories on that when they're using acupuncture you've seen?
Yes.
Or the customers have seen?
Seen results where we're softening those nodules or those masses, especially if they're related to pain. We're helping those pets feel better and they're moving better. And when they feel better, they can heal. When they're painful,
the
body can't heal.
Get and working so on it. Yeah.
If we can deal with, we can help them through this. We really have some good success with it. One of the next treatment modalities is going to be herbal medicine. That's what we use extensively as well with cancer treatment. And there are several different herbs that have what we call anti-neoplastic or anti-tumor effects. And it's really interesting seeing how that's becoming validated by conventional medicine.
Excellent.
So it's wonderful. And the herbs are great because they can be combined with a lot of the conventional medications as well. So we can then reduce the dosage a lot of time that's being given or eliminate some of the side effects that we might see.
Oh, that's excellent.
It's really great.
So when you have a plan for an animal that comes into you and the veterinary oncologist is working and you know exactly what kind of cancer medications they may be getting,
right,
you're able to design these herbal medicines for them to help them heal. That's excellent.
For them.
That's excellent, folks. Now, that's a very powerful statement that when you've learned about it, you either are doing something about it or you're not sure what to do, that you have something that could be added to their life to help either reduce in some cases. Is that what they're seeing? Reduction. Excellent.
It's fantastic.
So I had seen a chart in one of our books here, my books, that talked about if they're on this like chemo drug, this can be used. And it's so confusing. That's why when you start this journey, you don't want to always like try to do it yourself, even though there's great information out there, because sometimes it could come in a contradiction.
They can, you're right. So sometimes anything in excess can be bad. And so sometimes things will indicate one another. Mm-hmm. And so we trying to keep that open line of communication as to what the pet is being given. That way we know what do we need to tailor and what we can adjust so that we have the best options. So.
Wow. That's,
and pets, they take herbal medicines well. It's just a nice thing. Everybody worries, you know, giving pets medicine at home. And most of the herbal formulas are either capsules or powders.
Okay, I was going to ask you what the format was. Were they liquid tinctures? Were they capsules?
In humans, they are, and that's easy.
Okay.
Drink this.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
Sometimes our dog friends aren't always as accommodating. So the powders can be mixed with food. They can be disguised in a treat. The capsules, same thing. So it's a nice it's way to for be them. Able to administer to them. To
and the you pets. Don't usually have, like, because we'll hear that in the story, even with anything, like they don't want to take something, they're fussy eaters or something. So you find with the herbals that it's generally accepted by them?
They accept them, which is great.
Sometimes I wonder when they do accept things so easily, it's like their body and they know they need it.
They just know.
They know, and they know how it maybe has then eventually made them feel. And when you're really working with your dog and you're on that journey and those things start to happen, you know it. Like, it's just a, you're in a flow that's really working for them. I'm going to speak always from the human side, the caretaker side, while Dr. Burroughs has the science side. But honestly, when you're doing this and you're working with someone who knows what they're doing, the flow can come, right?
Right. And that's, here's a passion I know of yours is food therapy.
Yes.
And you already said, food is medicine. And we know that. And so with our food therapy, we utilize these different energetic properties of food to tailor a diet for a specific pet. And when we talk about energetics of food, it can be, people think of hot and cold, like food's either hot or it's cold. But there's also a different properties involved in the food. Even if something is cold, it could still give you a sensation of hot. A classic example is you could put a habanero pepper in the freezer.
Uh-huh.
You could eat it and you're still going to feel the
hot.
Warmth, right? You eat a curry dish and you feel those curry, that turmeric and that warmth in your body.
Oh yeah.
So there's different properties like that with food. And so what we're trying to do with food therapy is tailor a diet specifically for a pet. And when we're treating cancer, I think we have one on the next slide.
Do you want
a
go
little
to that
bit.
One?
I think so. Is
okay.
What we're trying to do is, from a general nutrition standpoint, is we want to be able to provide appropriate food and nutritionally complete food for them. We want it to be high quality. We want it to be easily digestible. We want to use whole foods and try to avoid anything that's overly processed. And the big goal is we need the pet to want to eat it. That's the most important thing.
Yes, you do want them to eat because they're getting in sometimes a mode where they don't want to eat.
They don't want to eat because they feel sick.
Yeah.
And we could have the best diet planned, but if they don't want to actually eat it, that's the problem. So there's some certain things that we can do to try and help that with them. Environmentally, we can offer multiple small meals throughout the day. That helps a lot. If they're feeling inappetent, you can heat the food to release some more of the aromas. Monitoring them for any signs of nausea, particularly if they're going through chemotherapy or radiation, they might be feeling nauseous as well. And so monitoring for those things and being cognizant that a lot of times pets are much smarter than we give them credit for.
Yes.
And so if they've had a bad experience with a certain food, they might not want to eat it again. Or if they were sick in a certain area of the home, they might not want to eat from that spot. So moving the bowl somewhere else, just being aware of their different needs with their food.
That makes so much sense. And I know when I was going through the journey and learned about back then about the carbohydrates and the sugars, of course, we were all learning it for humans as well, kind of at the same time. But, you know, he really came out at that point and said, look, you know, this is really reality where these are turning into sugars, which are feeding the cancer cells. And there's so much more to do. And I said to myself, well, then shouldn't we as healthy human beings also reduce our carbohydrates? Because if suddenly one day I find out my dog has cancer and I want to reduce carbs, shouldn't I have been starting to do that earlier?
Earlier on?
Kind of broke that thought of let's start looking at the foods in a different way as well. Mm-hmm. And let's look at everything that we're all eating and carb reduction. Does that make sense?
Oh, perfect. Yeah. It makes perfect sense. So we need to be more cognizant of what we're feeding.
Yes. Yes. Healthy or recovering.
Right. Or recovery.
For working through.
And I think, too, being aware of the environment and what we need to do in that regard. I mean, and being cognizant of the pet parent. I mean, in a perfect world, we would all eat, you know, wholesome, balanced meals every day.
Yes.
You know, but there are times when you pick up a pizza on the way home.
That's right.
And we have to be aware that our diet plan needs to be tailored to the lifestyle of the pet as well. You know, and what's going on in the home.
Mm-hmm. So you have to do with. You have to do a lot of that, just helping people walk through what they're willing to do, what their lifestyle allows them to do, what makes sense for them, and budget can
plays a factor.
Plays
as well.
A factor.
It does.
But we all want to do the best we can.
Chwina, this is a personal favorite of mine. Shuina is an ancient Chinese method of medical manipulation. And so it combines conventional massage techniques, if you want to call them that, acupressure points, and chiropractic techniques. And so you utilize your hands for healing, which is wonderful. And you can increase circulation, you can stimulate nerve function, all things to strengthen the immune system and promote normal organ function. I like it because we can use it before, let's say, an acupuncture treatment to relax the pet, identify any areas of tension. We can use it after to reinforce our treatment. But what I really love about it is we can teach people to do it at home.
To do it at home. Excellent.
And that's so important because then the pet owner is at home and can be using these techniques daily and being a part of the treatment plan. And
excellent.
We have cancer. We know our days are a gift. Mm-hmm. And so if we can take time each day to set aside, and the dogs love it. They love getting a massage.
Oh, my gosh, they do anyway. Now we're going to be more specific and more careful and knowledgeable.
And therapeutic, and we're helping their treatment plan, and it strengthens that bond.
Yes.
And it's wonderful. I love teaching Shuina techniques for people.
Does it take a long time for us to learn something like that?
It's easy, and it's funny because a lot of things people are already doing and they don't even realize it.
Okay.
Because the dog likes it. So he loves to have his ears stretched like that.
Yeah. That's interesting.
It's wonderful.
Oh, that's interesting.
It's a great part of care.
You mentioned acupressure points. Yeah, that's
exciting. I had not heard of that practice. Really cool. Yeah.
Do people, once they might have had they're in chemo, are you finding that folks are setting up like a regular schedule with some of these alternative integrative options? Like say they have a chemo, well then maybe 2 or 3 weeks later it's a good time to, is that starting to evolve with like how to set up a protocol, let's say, for health and wellness?
It's really starting to develop where there's so many players on the healthcare team.
Yes.
You know, we have, like you had mentioned, your primary care veterinarian who first identified we have a problem. And then we were at the oncologist. And that now we have integrative medicine. So we really have a whole team of people and communicating with one another to set up the best plan. So maybe that pet had surgery.
Yes.
Let's say they had surgery to have the mass removed. And now we're going to follow up with chemotherapy or radiation. Well, we need to develop a diet that's going to be supportive and therapeutic, and we need to be able to provide at-home care and pain relief. And so can we all develop this plan for each pet?
Yes.
So they've got the best options available to them.
That's my ideal world, Dr. Burroughs. Okay? I dream of that. I dream of being able to walk into a practice that's leading edge with us and see Dr. Burroughs there, Dr. Stern, who we've had on the program, and our integrative veterinarians are care specialists in veterinary care, whether it's orthopedic, digestive, skin, cancer, and all of the specialists and the emotional pieces, the integrative pieces coming together. So the day that I find out that my dog has cancer, I have a team that's going to come to me and say, you know, here's what we suggest as a protocol, and they're working together. What a world. What a world that would be. It's not happening yet. We hope someday in the future. I see it for humans at some of the cancer centers now that they're bringing in all the integrative care. And that's our hope because we want the best specialists and modalities and treatments.
We want to provide the very best we can.
Yeah.
It's going to be a beautiful world when that.
Okay. Let's just keep working towards that because I want to really know that and see that it happen. And I think part of that was when you're in the world like that and all of a sudden, you know, it shakes you up. It's almost what happened to me when one of my dogs suddenly was lame. And, of course, Lyme disease was big, you know. And I thought, oh, my gosh, it's going to be Lyme disease. And I went to call 911. And I went, what am I doing? They're not going to come for my dog. So it's when you wake up one day because of something going on like this and you say, well, where are my people? Like, where is the person that's going to help me walk through this? Who's going to help me coordinate natural supplements with a treatment plan? Who's going to help me tweak this diet and why? And so, because once you have that, you are empowered and your dog is empowered. Your positivity increases and you're able to take steps forward and know that you did everything you could. But we need the integration. So what a wonderful world that would be. I'm not going to sing. No one wants that. Do we have more here?
I believe that was the last one.
Well, this is Dr. Jennifer Burroughs, contact information. She's not far away, folks, in Lititz. And there is her information. Know she's there. And we have even more we can keep talking about with this, but please write that down. We can go back to that later. We may take a short break. I'd like you to see this video. So hopefully I'm going to get it up for us. If we can take a 5-minute break, can we do that, station? Can we take a break? All right, let's see if we can get our video going. Thank you. Thank you for staying with us. I think we have the video ready with Dr. Burroughs' help, the both of us. We got it going. So we're going to hit play. Now what I want to set up is this is the trailer for the dog cancer series coming in March. And we'll go from there because there's so much hope now in the world for canine cancer, I believe. There's a lot more to do, but so many good dedicated people who are taking the pledge. So let's see if we can get this to play.
Worldwide epidemic. An epidemic of unknown proportions.
What your body uses for fuel is incredibly important for managing disorders like cancer.
We've encouraged extremely narrow research, just looking at one gene, one pathway, and we know this doesn't work.
So about 16 months ago, I noticed a cough with Parker. It was discovered he had a lesion in his lung, which was pulmonary carcinoma.
The diagnosis hits you like a freight train, and most of the time you feel like there's nothing you can do.
At that point, we were given approximately 2 to 3 months. I thought Parker's gonna die, and what have I done wrong?
Dogs have a different diet than what's currently being advertised and employed.
We didn't do this. Throughout our life, throughout history, throughout generations, we did not have the same diet.
In the last 100 years, we've entirely changed a dog's food pyramid.
Little did I know, the fact of what I was feeding him probably was the part that was harming him.
Your typical standard diet, which includes pets, is predominantly carbohydrate driven.
We know that grain-based pet food is dirt cheap, but the companies that sell this pet food make much larger margins and profit.
We did not have the same diet that we have now, and we did not have the same problems that we have now.
We're going to beat this. We're going to do this, and we are going to beat this with diet.
There's no doubt that the therapeutic effects of this diet are profound.
And now we have a means of starving cancer.
It was almost within a month this diet was taking hold. But then the second month came. My vet looked at me and said, whatever you're doing, keep it going. And the third month happened. And we did a thoracic scan to see if the cancer had metastasized. Cancer free.
Nutrition is a really big hammer, we say, to correct a whole range of pathologies.
If we can do this with dogs, why can't we do it for me, you, and anyone else who may face this down the road?
And now we can. And
we will.
Made a brief introduction of that series in the summer of 17, and now the release is coming again in March, and many of us are very anxious about that. How does that feel to you, Dr. Burroughs, when you see something like this coming about, which was really driven by Rodney Habib, who is considered an irreverent pet blogger from Canada, and he started his blog, his business, he had a store kind of like mine, and started his business, and he got so angry when his dog was sick, and he realized he was feeding the wrong thing, and he was doing the wrong things. And he was irreverent, that's the word. And I knew it, but I wasn't that personality. And he has pushed the limits. He's got 50 veterinarians, he's got oncologists and people around the world researching this. So for me, as a grassroots and a mom that sees that now, he's working with Dr. Karen Becker and so many of the other ones that we've known over the years. Dr. Burroughs, how do you feel about this evolution coming, kind of bubbling up from
the grassroots? From people asking for more.
How do you feel about that?
It's exciting.
Good.
It's just an exciting time.
Good.
To know that that feeling of hopelessness and helplessness is going to start to go away.
Excellent.
People are going to be able to do more for their pets.
Excellent. And oh, I love to hear that. Do you have another question?
No, it's wonderful.
Another book that I think can help a lot of folks, because as you probably know by now that I'm pretty outspoken, and if I have a question to ask my veterinarian or my doctor or anybody that I'm working with, I have questions. And I'm not afraid to ask those questions, and it's not threatening, and it's not anything. It's just, help me understand the blood work. Help me understand this. Okay, I understand it now. This book helps a lot of you folks out there who don't know what to ask, and you may be sitting in an appointment with your veterinarian, and there is a term that comes up of the diagnosis, and you don't even know what that means, and you're giving something to give your dog. Ask the questions. Be an advocate for your animal. It's very, very important, and there's a nice check sheet in here. When your dog, what things to ask your veterinarian about treating your dog's cancer. It's amazing. There are tons of bullet points. Certainly you don't need to ask all these if you're comfortable, but it gives you a starting point for, oh my gosh, I'm hit with this. And maybe not that day. Maybe you're gonna have to digest it all, process it all, go home and then say, may I have a follow-up appointment to discuss what we're doing next? Don't feel you can't do that. Do that. Take the time to learn. So this is another resource for you. I think if you're already struggling with anything in the veterinary care, and you're just going, I don't know, I just got these pills, I don't know what to do with them, I don't know why I'm doing them. No, you need to know. And so there's resources there. The resource list that I had shown earlier has other websites to go to. Dr. Jennifer, you had a wonderful edition of a book that you mentioned that I added to my resource list about food therapy.
Yes.
Will that really benefit our lay people, people like us that want to know
more? Oh, it's easy to understand.
Okay.
Yes. It's from, it's Asian traditions.
Oh.
For food therapy. So yes. It's both human and animal.
Oh, that's excellent.
The principles apply to both.
Okay.
But it's easy to understand. It talks about Chinese medical theory and what foods we can use for not only well-being, but then treatment of a wide range of,
excellent,
of illnesses. I meant to add another one to there as well that's called Four Paws, Five Directions.
Four Paws, Five Corrections.
Right. Directions.
Directions.
Sorry. It's based on five element theory.
Oh, excellent.
It's written by a veterinarian, Dr. Schwartz. And so it goes into traditional Chinese veterinary medicine and how all these different things apply. That's another.
And it would be good for
be a good one.
Regular folks out there trying
right.
to learn more.
Trying to learn more. And I agree with exactly what you said for people to ask questions. Never feel like it's a one-sided dialogue. Please, I love it when people ask questions about, you know, what does this mean? You know,
yeah.
What you read a blood work report and you go, it's just a bunch of letters and numbers and
we don't know.
Yeah, ask.
And there's a range, and maybe your veterinarian doesn't feel like if it's a low or it's a problem, but maybe you see it. Ask. Just ask the question. You're your best advocate for your dog or your cat or whatever. So we appreciate that refreshing approach and hope more people can feel comfortable doing that. Any other final thoughts? Oh, was it fun?
This was great.
This was
an exciting time.
Great. Yeah. We all need to hear that out there, because in the store with us, we hear people every day that walk in that door, and there's a cancer story, there's a treatment story, there's confusion, there's just not sure about what they can and should do, and the best we can do right now is to advise them to seek alternative care. You know, concerns and do things differently. What I also, just some tips when you're going through this journey, I found it very important. I kept a journal. I kept a log of what was going on with my dog from the point that I heard the news. Just simple. You just can do it in a simple notebook. A date. This is what I learned. This is the treatment we had. This is the appointment I had. This is the drug they took or the alternative treatment. Just keep a little journal. It doesn't have to be hard. We have cell phones. We've got iPads. You're going to want to know that when you're going back. The other tip, and I find this is interesting, ask for your test results every time. Ask for a copy. You should keep that in your folders so that when you're going to another specialist, they may still want to resource them themselves, but you've got the information in front of you at any point in time. It helps with dialoguing, and it helps with just you knowing. No, I really did see the test result. The calcium was fine, or the phosphorus is in balance with the calcium. It helps you. So it's your dog's records. Ask for it. Some veterinarians now have online records keeping, and you know, take advantage of that. And the last thing, don't ever be afraid to ask for a second opinion in conventional veterinary care. So many times, I mean, we've had situations where a veterinarian may say things like, okay, your dog needs an ACL repair. Before rushing to surgery, sometimes there are alternative treatments and alternative ways. So please ask for a second opinion. Didn't we did this journey with human medicine. We did the same kind of journey. We're doing it now in veterinary medicine. Asking for your results, seeking a second opinion, feeling confident about your treatment plan, and working with people you can work with. I can't say it enough. It's very, very important.
I think so.
Any final thoughts?
No veterinarian is going to be offended if someone asks for a second opinion.
Right?
They shouldn't be.
They shouldn't be. Before your dog is being under surgery with anesthesia, be sure. And if you don't know who to go to for the second opinion first, your veterinarian should have that suggestion. They're probably working with a specialty practice.
That's true.
And if they're not, go to people who may know some of the better places to go for solid diagnostics.
And if you're looking to find veterinarians, there's the resources online, too.
Yes.
You had mentioned the American Association of
veterinary oncologist.
Yep.
They're on there. American Holistic Veterinary Medical Association, the World Association of Traditional Chinese Medicine. I mean, there's many. You can find a practitioner in your area for what you need.
Excellent. What your pet needs. So if any of you out there want this list, you can email. We'll show up our contact information for the show very quickly, very soon. We're at the end. Email us. I'll mail something out to you because I worked on the list when it first hit me. I do hand it out in the store, and of course I've revised it, and it's always being added to because unfortunately there's so many confusing sites out there, and you can go down paths that can get you into some not such good information. So we really work hard at providing solid information you can use. I hope this was helpful. I hope that you understand and think that there's hope. There are certainly your choices on budget, time, what the prognosis is for your dog, what kind of cancer they're dealing with, you know, and there's times to go to the acceptance, and there's times when you just keep pushing through because you're their advocate. So thanks again for joining us. Thank you, Dr. Burroughs.
Thank you so much. It really was a pleasure. Thank you.
Sorry for the technical difficulties today. Some days go really well and some days don't. We'll be back next month with another show for Dog is Family. I'm working on some interesting topics, and I hope you'll be back with us. It's the fourth Friday of the month. We'll see you later. Thanks again. Bye-bye.
Dog is Family on BCTV is supported by From Family Pet Foods.